light is the God, Lord Christopher, the living survival man. You and I'm back with another download straight from the cosmos. Remember, someone has to see your greatness. Why not start with yourself? Stay blessed, always finesse. Definitely trust the Most High's process, the truest keys to success. Hey, listen, man, we've been rocking, we've been vibing out, we've been doing our thing with these videos. The See Your Greatness podcast has become something so inspirational. Just overall, it's just been amazing, man. Like, from the feedback that I've been getting, how I've been personally feeling every single day that I do these videos, even sometimes when I don't feel my best, I always look forward to getting on here and just educating everybody about things that, you know, I may be experiencing, things that help push me through my daily life, things that help me get through mentally, physically, spiritually, financially, and things that I find, you know, in research that I then apply work to. If it works for me or if it doesn't work for me, I get up here and, you know, I share the information. I feel like that's what it should be about. I'm stepping into my role. I'm stepping into, you know, I guess you can say the reason for me being here. And that's to teach, that's to educate, that's to give different perspectives on how we can progressively build our mind, our spirit up so that we can obtain all of the things that we desire, any of our goals or our objectives that we might have on a daily, weekly, monthly, yearly, you know what I'm saying, short term, long term. I love to inspire people to just go after it, you feel me? I love to motivate others. I love to educate others. I love to enlighten others about things that have helped me. So I appreciate y'all who have been, again, commenting, messaging, DMing, calling, tapping in, and allowing me to hear how these videos have helped. So, yeah, man, I appreciate y'all. I love y'all. And we're going to continue to keep the ball rolling. So let's continue to get into the vibes, all right? Vibes here at SYG Studios are to motivate, educate, and enlighten our people to achieve greatness through seeking new ways to invest in themselves. Everything is high level. What we think, what we say, how we feel, and definitely how we act. But before we even get into the energy, take the time to like, comment, share, and subscribe. We love engagement over here and understand that a village pushes the trend, not just one individual. So the support is much appreciated. Also, take the time to tap into the link. Join the SYG community on all social platforms, all right? Book a one-on-one consultation to obtain personal guidance, vendor resources for your brand, cop merch, sign up for the email and SMS text list, or even donate to the brand, to the legacy, so that we can continue to improve our quality, do give backs, things of that nature. Our aim is to not only grow the brand, the legacy, but reach at least 500K, yes, I said 500K, a little slight half a milli, individuals who want, need, and are seeking the knowledge to live a more abundant life. Now, with all the information being provided, I gotta do this. I gotta send out a quick disclaimer. Please take the time to do your own research, family. It's very vital. My content is intended to be used for motivational purposes only. Always do your own analysis based on your own current circumstances. Now, here's my favorite part. Now, all together, let's go ahead and step into our armor. Let's go ahead and step into our God body energy. We're going to inhale peace. We're going to exhale so we can receive that growth and ultimately see our greatness. All right? So let's get to it. Inhale peace. Exhale growth. See your greatness. Here's what we are learning and tapping into today. Today is episode 33 of the See Your Greatness podcast. And on this episode, I wanted to talk about self-control. That has been the word or the message that has been coming to me a lot. Mind you, these videos, they come as I receive messages throughout the day, throughout meditation, throughout my readings, whether I'm listening to, you know, motivational videos, going through, you know, my own self-analysis of how I'm feeling and what I need to work on. The word that has kept reappearing has been self-control and self-discipline. So that lets me know that, hey, God's trying to get you on track to talk about self-discipline, especially in this transition, no period. You definitely want to be disciplined and have self-control over this last quarter of the year. They say the first quarter and the last quarter are the most important, how you come out and how you end it, right? So as we are shifting, as we are transitioning in our mental season, our spiritual season, our financial season, whatever season you're transitioning in, self-control is going to be the key. Self-awareness, self-discipline. So today I wanted to talk about that. You know, I'm going to go over the definition of self-control or self-discipline. And then I'm going to show a video. I already have it queued up over here. Someone who I believe embodies this. A gentleman by the name of David Goggins. Very inspirational person. Somebody that if I needed in my corner to amp me up, amp up my mind, amp up my spirit, just get me in order, get me out of chaos, this is somebody that I can definitely say does that for me, especially. You know, I turn on one of his interviews or his videos, and he speaks with just so much passion, conviction, through all of the things, trials and tribulations that he has been through. It molded him to be this God that he is, you know. So I'm gonna definitely want to play this video for you guys and you know, just discuss how he has changed my mind and my perspective when it comes to shooting for goals and you know, sticking to what you say you were going to stick to, practicing that self-control. We're gonna tap into a couple of verses that I found within the good book too. Talks about self-control. You know, this book talks about a lot of different things, and I am a firm believer that it is a accumulation of truth, right? Accumulation in story form, metaphorical, allegorical, parables, that educate us on how we should operate in life. It educates us on how, you know, things will occur in your life if you aren't practicing discipline, if you aren't practicing self-control, if you don't have the ability to use discernment, if you're walking in jealousy, if you're walking in fear. That's what these stories are about when you actually take the time to decode it. So we're going to discuss that. And then you already know we're going to move into some new upgrades, day 24 TPQ, and then we're going to get out here with some words of wisdom. So today I wanted to discuss self-control. So I wanted to pull up the exact definition of, you know, self-control and, you know, what it means, right? So self-control is the ability to control oneself, in particular, one's emotions and desires, or the expression of them in one's behavior, especially in difficult situations. So, like, that's really key right there, because I feel like, this is just me talking personally, most of my difficult situations that I got through by practicing self-control, learning how to express myself in particular situations, it helped create a better me. It helped create a better version, more seasoned, more wise person, rather than, you know, moving out of a lack of knowledge, moving in a season where I lack the wisdom and I'm just reacting to things instead of properly responding, effectively responding. So self-control, the ability to control oneself, in particular, one's emotions. We got to learn to control those. You know, like there was a quote, and I believe I said this before, like, are you allowing feelings to lead you, or are you leading feelings? Do you have the understanding that feelings are temporary, right? One minute you might be mad, and the next minute you're laughing, having the best time of your life. These things or these energies are temporary, so you need to know how to monitor them. You need to know how and when to put yourself in particular situations. And within all that, it's just you practicing self-control of who you are, what you're feeling, and what you are obtaining to do in your life. Self-control, an aspect of inhibitory control, is the ability to regulate one's emotions, thoughts, and behavior in the face of temptations and impulses. Like, are you somebody that succumbs to temptation a lot? You know what I'm saying? Like, to my men out here, are you the ones who, scrolling on your phone and you see somebody that, you know, entices you physically, and now you going to hop on the hub. You feel me? Get one off, and then you just wasted your essence. You're wasting your source of creation. You're wasting your source of knowledge. Or ladies, you feel what I'm saying? Are you moving off impulse? Are you someone who gets stressed out and you may binge eat? You may feel like you need to go shopping to help you get out of a situation or a particular mindset that is, you know, giving you anxiety or fear. We all have our something, right? So an aspect with inhibitory control is the ability to regulate one's emotions, thoughts, and behavior in the face of temptations and impulses. That's when you know you have self-control. When you are faced with temptations and impulses, when it's something that is happening out of nowhere and you have to make that quick decision, that's how you know you have real strong self-control. You're not wavered. You're not shaken up. You know how to assess the situation effectively and efficiently so you can know, again, how to respond. As an executive function, it is a cognitive process, a mental process, all right, that is necessary for regulating one's behaviors in order to achieve specific goals. Things have to be regulated. Things have to be placed in order. Because if things aren't in order, there is chaos and there is dysfunction. And that's not how God has designed us to live. That's not what the highest source of creation has designed us to live. No. Even the highest source had a plan. First day, second day, third day. Like, it was planned out days on what was going down. We're going to have the light on this day, then the darkness. I'm going to separate that. Then we're going to go ahead and start with the creations of the sun, the moon, the stars. I'm going to create that. You know, like, each and every day it had a plan. And it started moving progressively towards that plan. It has always knew who it was. It knew where it was going with its creations and the blueprints. And it created all the things that it needed to form. You're no different. Gotta have self-control. So I'm gonna actually go to a scripture first that talks about it, and then I wanna show y'all my guy, David Goggins. Alright, so this is Galatians, right? Galatians chapter 5. And I started at verse 16, and it talks about how, you know, just having, again, self-control over yourself is fruitful. And how lack of self-control pretty much leads you to your destruction in many different ways. Right? So it goes like this. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Right? For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit. And the Spirit, in the Spirit against the flesh. So it's already telling you right there, like, they don't rock with each other. You feel what I'm saying? They don't like each other. One has different motives that the other doesn't like, and vice versa. So they are always, it's always like this cat and mouse with them. You feel me? I don't rock with you. You don't rock with me. I know what I'm here to do. You know what I'm saying? I'm here to seek and destroy, while the other is here to provide peace and love. All right? So it says, and these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law. Now, the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these. So if you're walking in the flesh, if this is like you not walking in a sense of control, because we got to understand that the body, the housing agent of our spirit, is not in control. It becomes in control when you allow it to. When you allow it to become the quote-unquote beast. When you allow it to lead you towards things like adultery, cheating, fornication, watching on the hub. You know what I'm saying? Uncleanliness. Lack of hygiene. We can call it that. Lasciviousness. Now, I don't know that word. Let's go ahead and look up that word. Lasciviousness. That's a new one. I always like to learn new words. Lasciviousness. That is a definition of lasciviousness: feeling morbid, sexual desire, or propensity to lewdness, Synonyms, a the arousal of feelings of sexual desire. So that's all you thinking about is just sex all day. That's pretty much what that is. Idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, acting like other people, wrath, strife, seditious or seditions or heresies, like being like speaking false about things, envying, murdering, drunkenness, revelings, and such like. Of and all those of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Now we need to understand what the kingdom of God means. It's more than, you know, this place that you go to when you are deceased. Again, it is a place where the highest source of energy, where the highest source of creation, where the highest source of knowledge rests, right? And you have the ability to experience that while you are here on earth. However, you have some, you know, bosses that you need to defeat, right? And not even defeat, you need some bosses that you need, there are bosses that you need to get in order, because in retrospect of the all of this, it's you versus you. You are your own God. You are your own devil. This is a mental thing. This is a spiritual thing. Whatever you allow or you take on within your spirit, whether it's like you're saying, I am dot, 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 and that dot, dot, dot is something negative, you're going to take that on. Your spirit is going to start to take on that energy. It's the difference between you becoming the villain within yourself or the hero within yourself. And that can also then trickle down into others. You feel what I'm saying? So the kingdom of God is just like that resting place of where you are, where you allow your energy to rest. Are you allowing it to rest in hell, or are you allowing it to rest in heaven? Are you allowing it to be consumed in devilish like, or are you allowing it to be consumed in living more godly? That's how you decode these things, all right? Let's move on. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. So those who walk in that, it's just like when it says there is no law, it's like there's no catch. You know what I'm saying? Consequence to that. Like, how can you be mad at somebody or try to destroy something that's walking in peace and love, right? You feel what I'm saying? Like, who, somebody who want to do that has to be, they have to hate themselves, pretty. And they that are Christ's have crucified the flesh with the affectious, with the affections and lust. So, when it says, and they that are Christ's, that our Christ have crucified the flesh, is basically saying that like you're Christ like mind. Like what Christ means is to be in knowledge of. Like that's what my name means. My name means Christopher, right? My name is Christopher, and then the Christopher means bearer of Christ. It means the bearer of knowledge. Bearer of knowledge, the bearer of Christ. So with that, that means that I understand and I understand on what side of the pendulum that I need to be in. Based off of like the knowledge that I have, the accumulation of truth that I have, based off of that, I take on that. And that allows me to be able to put the flesh in order. Nah, we ain't doing that. We're not watching that. We're not listening to that. We're not allowing the flesh to lead me. I am leading the flesh. My spirit is leading. You feel what I'm saying? So let's keep going. And we're literally on like the last two verses. If we live in spirit, let us also walk in the spirit. All right. Let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another or envying one another. That talks about self-discipline right there. That all of that is self-discipline. These are the things that literally, if you are walking in your highest mind, the highest form of yourself, these scriptures are telling you what you will obtain. You'll obtain peace. You'll obtain joy. You feel what I'm saying? You'll obtain a temperance instead of an intemperance. You'll obtain wealth. You'll obtain richness and whatever that looks like. You'll obtain success. I guarantee it. Because you are at your highest form. You're on the journey of reaching your highest potential. So along the journey, everything that is around you has to be at its highest form as well. Because you'll be able to recognize it right then and there. That hold on, we're not on the same vibe. We're not on the same frequency. We're not having the same conversations. Like, the more and more you grow within yourself in all areas, you'll start to weed out the things that have been hindering you, causing you to be weak in your flesh, causing you to be weak in your mind, causing you to be weak in your spirit. What are you taking on? And so this is one guy, man, again, David Goggins, one guy that mastered that. And I want y'all to hear from him and how he mastered going from almost 300 pounds, feeling worthless about himself and things of that nature, and then realizing and desiring to have a better life for himself, and what he took himself through to get there, practicing self-control and self-discipline.
97 pounds, and I was fat as hell trying to be a Navy SEAL. The scariest thing in the world to me, even to this day, was that that could have been the rest of my life. I thought then I was trying hard. That's the scariest thing in the world. I thought then, 297 pound, working for Ecolab, spraying for cockroaches, making $1,000 a month, I thought that was me at my 100% potential. Mm-hmm. Come to find out, a few years later, I wasn't anywhere near that. 106 pounds less, graduated Navy SEAL training, went on to do all these other things. Looking back on that, that was me trying hard. That's why people gotta understand, what is in us, we have no idea until we start trying hard.
Facts.
And I mean really Facts. Trying hard, where you're obsessed with, hey, this is my new norm. My new norm is that, wow, this isn't always fun.
Facts.
It's not always meant to be fun. And that's when you know you're trying hard. People hear my story and think this guy is sadistic. I realized how the brain works. I figured out how the brain works. I'm a scared kid. And that's what gives me so much power. I had no foundation, and I built this off of just researching the mind. The
Action.
Feeling you get is basically invincibility.
Mm-hmm.
You realize that you can't do it all the time.
Mm-hmm.
When you need to do it, I know I can go to a place that I can live in. And when you know that you can run on broken legs, and you can do certain things that a lot of people can do, but they're not willing to do. This power, this sympathetic nervous system of fight or flight, and you're fighting. It gives you this charge of energy of when you're sitting there at 3:30, 4 o'clock in the morning, and you're duct taping your feet up because they're broken, and you're doing it by yourself, and you're going through arguably one of the hardest training in the world. And these guys, most of them are healthy, and you're going through it broken, and you are at a disadvantage, but you're still there.
Mm-hmm.
You can feed into that and tap into that for a lot of power.
Thanks.
But if you look at it, well, I'm broken, man. Like, I'm not going to make it. But if you look at it as, man, I'm broken, and I'm still here, and I'm fighting, and I'm going to find a way to get through this because I have no other place to go. It gives you a lot of power.
Mm-hmm.
When things start to suck really, really bad, my brain and a lot of people's brain, they don't go to your dad beating you up. Your brain says, we gotta get out of here. This mm-hmm. is miserable.
Mm-hmm.
So anger goes away a lot of times when you're suffering, because your brain just says, we gotta run, we gotta go. So that anger is not popping up saying, oh, I wanna show them, I wanna show those people. No, there has to be a much deeper. When I say deeper, it has to be down to mineral soil. It has to be down to that nice mineral soil where nothing can burn.
Mm-hmm.
You can't burn dirt. So it has to be down that low that literally is something in you that's at the core of your soul.
Right.
But you don't find it unless you spend a lot of time with what you want to be in life.
Facts.
I can't give that to you. Right. You can't give it to somebody. When you find your true passion in life, and my passion for me was like, oh, I want to be in the Navy SEALs, Army, I don't give a shit. I want to serve my country. I cared about, I want to be someone that I'm proud of. Mm-hmm. I want to look at myself in the mirror because I was so disappointed. That accountability mirror I talk about, I was so disappointed in what I saw every day. I wanted everybody to love David Goggins. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people did. I didn't love myself. But I knew a lot of us want to find peace first. So people say, man, you always talk about this suffering and pain. I'm at peace right now because right. I went through that.
Right.
You don't find peace first. If you do, Merry Christmas. More power to you. More power to you. I found peace on the opposite end of finding myself. Mm-hmm. And no one really finds himself without going through trials, tribulations, suffering, accountability.
Facts.
And accountability is suffering. Being accountable every day for doing right for yourself, for the people next to you, it's miserable. It's hard. So, you know, even the smallest details.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Listen, man, like that guy right there, I'm telling you, he is the definition of going through things. He is the definition of that. He is the definition of going through any and everything that has been tough in his life, going through being bullied, going through, you know, almost being 300 pounds, like just going through and battled depression. Like he went through it all. I think he said he did like 2 hell weeks in the military. I heard like those are very like hard, right? But he got so deep, like he said, within himself, like how he says, like the mineral soil, how it can't burn. He got so deep down there within himself that, you know, he just realized like this is all up to me. He put himself in a sunken place, right? So that he can understand that state of himself. So that he can help himself each and every step of the way get to his truest and full potential. But you can't do that without self-control. You cannot do that without self-discipline. Because it starts with you. Nobody can give you that. I can get up here and talk about it 24/7. But if you do not put the action in to actually utilize that practice, it's like talking to a doorknob, yo. So, you know, that's the message of the day, man. Self-control. Let's learn to practice some self-control. If you need tips on how to practice self-control, it's easy, man. You know, you can Google these tips. You can get a mentor. Get on YouTube and, you know, ask YouTube to find you different tips and things of that nature about self-discipline. But, again, at the end of the day, no matter how much research and information you gather, you have to put the work in. It might be you dedicating time to say, you know what, 10, 15 minutes a day, I'm going to work out. Or you know what, I'm going to cook for myself and not spend all of my money on eating out. Or I'm going to get off of social media for a month. Like, do something that challenges you. And as you challenge yourself each and every day, even when those temptations, even when those impulses are there, you lead the situation and you say to yourself, like, no, I'm not doing this. You don't allow your flesh and you don't allow anything else outside of you to control you. Take the time to relax. Realize that this emotion or this feeling or this thought is temporary. Get through it and keep moving in a progressive direction to achieve your greatness. Alright. Now, that was the knowledge of the day, man. And we're going to go ahead and move into new upgrades. Something that I, you know, seen today in an article. Your boy Jordan, richest basketball player ever with $3.5 billion $3 billion fortune. Oh, okay. I got to subscribe to this. Let me actually change this up. Let me go ahead and put this in Google right quick. Michael Jordan isn't just the greatest basketball player of all time. He's also the wealthiest. The NBA's icon sale of his stake in the Charlotte Hornets earlier this month set his net worth at an estimated $3.5 billion, according to Bloomberg Billionaires Index, which calculated Jordan's fortune for the first time. $3.5 billion, bruh? That's crazy. Let's read into this. Jordan, who led the Chicago Bulls to 6 NBA titles and won 5 MVP awards, became the league's second black majority owner in 2010 when he bought a controlling stake in the Hornets, then known as the Bobcats. But it was that legendary licensing agreement with Nike in the 1980s that really built his multi-billion dollar fortune. Shout out to Mama Jordan for that too. If y'all haven't watched the movie Air, y'all should definitely go watch that. A lot of gems in there. Jordan was literally the godfather of, you know what I'm saying, players getting equity and stuff like that in their brand deals and their shoe deals and things like that. Nobody was doing that. His mom, you feel what I'm saying, put him on game with that. And now we have kids today who are able to do licensing deals with like Puma, Nike, things of that nature, keep their name, likeness, and their image, and do partnerships. No, you can't own me, but we can partner together and collaborate together. You feel what I'm saying? You utilize my talents, my IP, things of that nature, and I utilize your work engine. And we work together like that to make money for each other or to build our audience, however the deal is structured. The Hornets stake sale follows a standout 2022 for sports team transaction and affirms the NBA status among the world's most profitable leagues. Its franchises have soared in value in recent years as billionaires have used their vast wealth to become owners. Matt Ishbia, who founded wholesale mortgage lender UMW Holdings Corp., agreed last year to buy more than 50% of the Phoenix Suns in a record deal that valued the club at $4 billion. Like, people out here making moves, man. Y'all keep saying money is evil. Money isn't evil. It's what you do with the money, and it's the person that's behind that tool. It's utilized to, and a lot of people around the world find it valuable because they want to use it to create things that they desire. You feel what I'm saying? Jordan sold his ownership in the Hornets to a group led by Gabe Plotkin, founder of Melvin Capital Management, and Rick Schnall, co-president of private equity firm Clayton Dubilier and Rice. As part of the $3 billion deal, Jordan retains an undisclosed minority stake. So he still has stake in the Hornets. So he's smart. According to the team, Bloomberg's estimate assumes he sold a 65% stake in the team and kept a less than 5%. And he's also at that point in time, man, like, he can get whatever he wants. He can get whatever he wants. So it's just like, you know, he's did the GM thing. He understands, you know, how that role goes. And now it's just like, at this point, like, just make money off that investment, man. Like, you feel me? No, even no matter where it goes, you're going to make money off of it. Like, it's not about the greed or anything anymore. I would hope so. So, in 2020, he launched... Okay, so this is more? Hold on. Jordan has also invested in other sports-related businesses, Bloomberg Ags. In 2020, he launched NASCAR's 223XI Racing, whose roster includes Bubba Wallace, the circus only black driver. The same year, Jordan received an equity interest in DraftKings, where he serves as a special advisor to the board. The size of his stake in the massive sports betting company, which started trading publicly in April 2020, is undisclosed. Now is the time for me to hand over the reins. See what he said? He's 60 years old. Jordan 60 said in August. And, I mean, that's not old or anything, but you know, I think he's just realizing, like, I've did it. You know, this ain't something that, you know, I'm not going to say he was the best at it, but let's be honest. Jordan said in August 3rd, open letter to Hornets fan, I'm excited to see what the future holds, and I look forward to supporting the team and the community in my new role for many years to come. In recent years, other athletes have pursued their own long-term brand deals with sports apparel lines in the hopes of being like Mike. Under Armour, Inc. announced in March that it reached a long-term deal with the NBA star Stephen Curry. for his Curry brand that includes an annual cash payment, incentives, royalties, and stock. You see what I'm saying? Like, Jordan built the foundation for this. And our NBA All-Star LeBron James built up a roughly $1.5 billion fortune through sponsorships, investments, and his own consumer and entertainment business, the Spring Hill Co., according to the index. Simeon Siegel, an analyst for BMO Capital Markets, told Bloomberg that Jordan Brand has transcended him as a player. Many of its customers are too young to have even seeing him play professional basketball. Facts. Jordan the person and Jordan the brand have helped shape Nike as well as the entire athletic apparel landscape. I just love seeing greatness, yo, like in all aspects. You feel what I'm saying? Like, no matter how people feel about him, you know, he knows what he's doing when it comes to business, man. $3.5 billion. The richest basketball player ever, invested in multiple different things. And that's what it's about. It's about investing in your community. It's about investing in your desires. It's about investing in your dreams. And, you know, constantly moving towards that. That's what I look for. That's what I look to do as well. Just continue to build. Just continue to put my mind, my spirit, and even, you know, myself in situations that are helping to build me, getting myself around like-minded individuals who want to do these things. These are the type of things in the conversations that I personally want to have. And it's not about, oh, I think I'm better or anything. Like, I know what poverty looks like. So I want to know what luxury looks like on the scale that I want to reach. Like, I want to be the best at any and everything that I can possible. I ask myself every day, like, how would God want to live? God wants to live like the best. God wants to live in its highest form. And that's tailored to person by person. I shouldn't feel wrong for wanting to have however much money I want in the world. And nobody else should feel wrong whether money isn't of importance to them. It's whatever luxury looks like to you. And he did this by, guess what? Practicing self-control, practicing self-discipline, and striving towards it. His airness is the NBA GOAT of making money, baby. And he is. He really is. So y'all can check that article out. This is on Maxim.com. You know, they got luxury, entertainment, style, things of that nature. Yeah, man, that was a vibe, yo. That was a vibe. Let me see if I can close this up. Try to close this up. Okay. That was a vibe, man. That was a vibe. So y'all let me know, man. Y'all out here practicing the art of self-control or no? Huh? I feel like you should, because it's gonna get you places. So let's go ahead and move into TPQ, man, and let's go ahead and get up out of here. 100 days of thought-provoking questions, questions that I would ask the 1% of how they got to where they were and how they continue to, you know, not only just stay motivated, but push others to get to the level that they are, if they are. So we're on day 24, question 24. What does a typical day look like for you, and how do you maximize productivity? What does a typical day look like for you, and how do you maximize productivity? So for me, my typical day, I get up around like 5 a.m. I meditate, I walk Paws is my husky. I let him do his thing. Sometimes I might get in the bed and not go back to sleep, but just like brainstorm and prepare for what I need to do today. Once I do that, you know, I go work out. I try to work out most of the time or most of the days before. I want to be finished with all of that, showered and everything before 8 a.m. So between 8 a.m. and 9, that's when I'll like look at my emails, see what work I need to get done. You know, check my calendar board to see if I have any tasks or anything that day. Go over my daily objectives, things of that nature, look at my core values. And just depending on what I want to do that day, like say I want to design some merch, I'll pick a time slot for that. So I'll work on that for an hour. Say if I have work for a client, I'll work on their project for a couple hours. I try to make sure that I keep time slots so I don't want overwork myself. And two, like being at a desk all day, it's not always fun, even when you're working out of your own home, right? I put time in to be able to go outside, walk, run with the dog, ground earth, get some sunlight, because that's very important. It helps with you staying sane. It helps with you staying healthy and active. Then I usually don't break my fast until around like 12, 12:30-ish. Check in with wifey, see how her day is going at work. She usually comes home, around like 3:30, 4 o'clock. Whether then I put time, like it's just I just make sure that it's structured. She's the one who actually got me organized with having a planner and having a calendar. And at first I was just out here just moving with the flow, man, letting the damn ocean take me wherever it wanted to take me. But once I started getting a plan and sticking to it, I started to see myself again be more productive. So that's the key right there, getting organized, practicing self-control, getting disciplined, and doing your do's before you do your wants. And that's how you produce more productivity within your day. Not everybody has to be an early bird like me. Like at least get up before 7, 8 o'clock, y'all, to get your day started. Anytime after that, like the day's pretty much running you. You're being led by the day. On the weekends, sometimes those will be my sleep in days. I'll try to I like to knock everything out throughout the week. Sometimes I can finish everything in like 3 or 4 days, depending on how many projects I've had. And then I'm doing what I want to do Thursday, Friday throughout the what we call the weekend. But my goal is to literally get to a point to where I can wake up every day and do whatever I want. Like, and me doing whatever I want is something like being able to be over in Costa Rica, but working on something, working on a project, still being productive, still maybe having high level meetings and conversations, still being productive, putting work in, but doing it, in my own environment, doing it on my own time. Or rather, utilizing time effectively and efficiently, how God bestows it upon me. As long as my heart beats, as long as I have the breath within me, the spirit within me, as long as I have a sane mind, my goal is to live it at its greatest form. So, it took me a while to get to this point, but that's what I promote, and that's what I'm gonna continuously push throughout my days here. You feel me? Like, live every day like you have an expiration date. That has been like my motto every single day now. Coming to that realization that one day Christopher Drew Jr. in the physical is not going to have that name, is not going to be in this physical body anymore. I might transition into someone else, but while I'm this form, while I'm in this shell, I'm gonna work every day to push myself to the fullest potential, and I'll know when I've reached it. So yeah, man, that was the question of the day, day 24, 100 days of thought-provoking questions. What does a typical day look like for you, and how do you maximize productivity? All my teachers out there, educators, entrepreneurs, y'all drop y'all comments down below. And yeah, man, let's continue to get active. Let's continue to get active. Now, where's the wisdom? And we're gonna go ahead and get out of here for tonight, family. What is the words of wisdom for today? We have, I like to write them down in my notes. Right, so words of wisdom. Life is a journey filled with challenges, opportunities, and moments of growth. Embrace each experience with an open heart and a curious mind. Remember that setbacks are stepping stones to success, and every moment is a chance to learn and evolve. Believe in your own strength. Know your own strength. Trust the path you're on, and never underestimate the power of perseverance. Your journey is uniquely yours, and you have the ability to shape your destiny with every choice and decision you make. Keep moving forward with courage, compassion, and a positive spirit, knowing that you are capable of achieving greatness. And listen, man, I couldn't have said it no more. Couldn't have said it no better. You feel me? So, with that being said, I love y'all. I appreciate y'all. I'm trying to block this basket back there with folding clothes. I love y'all. I appreciate y'all, man. This has been an amazing, amazing show. Continue to like, comment, share, and subscribe. Continue to just tap in with the legacy. Let's continue to build and collaborate with one another. Again, anyone who is interested in coming on and sharing your knowledge as well, don't hesitate to hit the link. Don't hesitate to shoot me an email. Let me know, you know, what your craft or what your area of expertise is. And we'll go ahead and schedule a day and time to, you know, do a live interview, or we can just do a pre-recording and I'll upload it later to all of my social media platforms. We all need to come together and just build and educate one another on how we reached our greatness, or how we are seeing ourselves evolve on our journey too. So with that being said, I love y'all. I appreciate y'all. We locked in. You feel what I'm saying? And get out here and see your greatness. Remember, someone has to see your greatness. Why not start with yourself? Stay blessed. Always finesse. Definitely trust the Most High process. The truest keys to success. Love y'all. Peace.